Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Welcome back on this discussion on Surah Isra, related to Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 22 to 36. Now I would like to move to Brother Arsh. Brother Arsh, Islam today universally is criticized for being a barbaric religion, being a religion which promotes unlawful killing, killing of the innocents, terrorism, etc., etc. So, according to the Quran, I know that it is haram to kill any innocent life. But today, the minds of the people have been influenced to that extent that they do not really know that in Islam, killing any innocent is a sin. What they think is the wrong image sent by the media to the people that Islam promotes killing of the innocent, Islam promotes terrorism, and Islam is a cruel religion. So what do you say about this? What does the Quran say about killing an innocent?
It's a very, very good question, mashallah. Allah says in Surah Isra, and do not kill any soul which Allah has made it forbidden, except by rights. When Allah says, do not kill any soul, it includes the prohibition of killing any other soul, even killing your own self. As we know, in Islam, suicide is a heinous sin because this life is a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the right to destroy it. No one has the right. We find that people, they commit suicide because they have lots of problems in life. They think that they have escaped the problems. But in fact, escaping a smaller problem, they have got into a much bigger problem. Because the person who commits suicide, for example, he jumped from the 10th floor. So in the year after, he will fall from the same height and he will die multiple times. Allah says in the Quran, مَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ أَوْ فَسَادٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَكَعَنَّمَ قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. That whoever kills an innocent human being, except it be for murder and corruption in land, it is as though he has killed the entire humankind. So, murder in Islam is completely prohibited.
Thank you, Brother Arsh. Brother Farik, like moving to you, is that there is a section of society, the orphans, who are less fortunate and who do not have parents. And we know that having parents is an important part of life. So, we understand that they are children who are less fortunate and do not have that kind of emotional support and the upbringing by their parents that is needed. And so there is some kind of responsibility that we have towards them, okay? Some kind of responsibility, like in any form, whether it be emotional help, financial help. So what are the rights of the orphans? Like what does the Quran mention about protecting and granting the rights of an orphan?
As far as the rights of the orphans are concerned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the glorious Quran, in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 34. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. And come not near to the wealth of the orphans except but to improve it. As we all know, the Sahaba, they were the most righteous people after the Anbiya, after the Prophet. So moment a verse was revealed, they immediately happened to implement it. For example, when the verse regarding the prohibition of alcohol was revealed, the streets in Medina, they were filled with alcohol. As people, they threw alcohol. Some of them, they threw it from the bottles. Some of them, while they had it in their mouth, they vomited it out. So these were the Sahaba. Whenever any verse was revealed, they used to immediately try to implement it. So coming back to the question that Brother Abid raised, so when this verse was revealed, that come not near to the wealth of the orphans except to improve it. So the Sahaba, says in the glorious Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 2, that do the best thing with the orphans. And if you mix your affairs, mix it with theirs, for they are your brethren. So after this verse was revealed, the Sahaba, they understood the concept, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was meaning by this verse. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the glorious Quran, in Surah Ma'un, chapter number 107, verse number 1 and 2, أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ. Have you seen the one who denies the day of recompense? فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ. For he is the one who turns away orphans. So it is a sin to reject the orphans. In fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he too was an orphan. So as far as the teachings of Islam are concerned, we need to take care of the orphans and we need to respect them.
JazakAllah, Brother Farid. Brother Faisal, now it's a common issue nowadays. There is a kind of a trust deficit. It's like nowadays a common trend that people aren't really finding it important to keep up to their promises or fulfilling their promises. Now, nowadays it's being like you are considered to be cool. You know, you're a cool person if you are successful in trying to ditch any person or unlawfully trying to, you know, break a promise. So how do you make people understand that what they do, fulfilling a promise, is really very important in Islam? I mean, there is a kind of, it's taken very easy that, okay, I'll be here by this time, and then even if I'm not there, it's not a big deal. I'll do this, even if I don't do it. So it's taken quite easily. So, Brother Faisal, how do you make people understand that it is really important and haram if you do not fulfill a promise? And nowadays, it has costed and it has even affected our relationships with people. Like, even if a Muslim, if he's an honest person, and if there's a person, he's already been, you know, cheated. So even if a person who is honest and he promises something or he deals with him into something, even that person isn't trusted, because of the person who has already cheated this particular person. So it affects our relationship overall. So how do you tell people that it is completely haram to do this, and how do they overcome this problem of breaking their promises?
You know, Brother Abid, this being cool can get you the heat of the fire. The Quran and the Sunnah clearly mentions that it is obligatory for everyone to fulfill our commitments, our promises, our words. And it is totally haram to be treacherous and to break our promises. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 34, وَأَوْفُوا بِالْأَهْدِ إِنَّ الْأَهْدَ كَانَ مَسْئُولًا. And fulfill every commitment. For the commitment is ever questioned. You'll be questioned for it. So a Muslim should be true to his word. And even in small matters, it doesn't mean like if you have given a big commitment or a business commitment or even in small matters, if you commit that I'll come by 5 o'clock, be there by 5. You should be true to your words. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ayatul munafiki thalath, idha hadatha kadab, wa idha wa'ada akhlaf, wa idha tumin khan. That the signs of hypocrites are 3. If he speaks, he tells a lie. If he makes a promise, he breaks it. And if he is entrusted, he proves to be dishonest. It's very dangerous that you have these qualities of hypocrites. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever breaks the commitment of a Muslim, may the curse of Allah, the curse of the angel, and the curse of the people be upon him. And Allah will not accept his obligatory salah, nor will he accept his nafil ibadat. So we should understand the severity of this matter. Another case which I remember is like inshallah. You know, inshallah is a escape word. Like you just say inshallah. No, people have lost trust in inshallah. If you want to just avoid a matter, you say inshallah. So people say, don't say inshallah, say whether you will come or not. Inshallah, if Allah wills, then only you will be able to do. But say inshallah and be committed to your word.
Brother Ismail, the Quran that is revealed to us is not only concentrating on the religious aspect. It's vast and it's in detail, and it teaches you about what do you have to do in daily activities, whether it's business, whether it's social activities, or whether it's anything for that matter, whatever concerning your life, day-to-day life. Nowadays, it's just a common scenario that we see that people are not really conscious when it comes to fair dealing with people. When it comes to fair dealing with people, people aren't really very conscious. what they think, that it's no problem if you cheat a person, even if it's for a little percentage. They don't find anything wrong in that. It's fine if you can gain some profit, some additional profit by telling lies or by cheating or, you know, manipulating your measurements. But actually, this is haram and completely not permissible in Islam, totally not permissible in Islam. We would like to take a short break and we would come back shortly. Stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back after the break. Brother Faisal, how do you tell people that it is completely haram to do this and how do they overcome this problem of breaking their promises?
You know, Brother Abid, this being cool can get you the heat of the fire. The Quran and the Sunnah clearly mentions that it is obligatory for everyone to fulfill our commitments, our promises, our words. And it is totally haram to be treacherous and to break our promises. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 34, وَأَوْفُوا بِالْعَهْدِ إِنَّ الْعَهْدَ كَانَ مَسْئُولًا. And fulfill every commitment. For the commitment is ever questioned. You'll be questioned for it. So a Muslim should be true to his word. And even in small matters, it doesn't mean like if you have given a big...
Chapter number 17, verse number 36. And pursue not in that which you have no knowledge of. For the seeing, the hearing, and the heart, and the sight, all of it you will be questioned about. So this verse is talking about people that believe in superstitious beliefs or believe in mere assumptions. And many people believe in assumptions and they do not have any knowledge over it. For example, there are various superstitious beliefs, whether it be in the moral aspect, whether it be education, whether it be art, whether it be culture. So let's discuss a few superstitious beliefs that the common people have today. Many people, they have a superstitious belief that if a black cat crosses my road, it is a sign of bad luck. And another kind of superstitious belief is that if a crow crows, so there will be guests that will be coming at home. And many people, they specially wear certain good clothes on specific occasions, believing that it will be a form of good luck and that day will go good. And if these superstitious beliefs, these assumptions are mixed up with religion, then it falls into the category of bidah, that is innovation. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that kullu bid'atin dalalah wa kullu dalalatin finnar, that every innovation is a sin and that will lead into hellfire. So therefore we need to take utmost care as far as these superstitious beliefs are concerned, and we need to have complete tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever happens is due to the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever is going to happen in the future has already been written. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written something, that is definitely going to happen. Whereas these other things cannot affect our lives because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already written our destiny and what we are going to do in the future.
JazakAllah khair, Brother Farik. In conclusion, I would like to end this discussion today with the verse of the Holy Quran, Udkhulu fi silmi kaffa, enter into the religion of Islam wholeheartedly. And I would like to thank all my panelists today who have come and spent their precious time with us for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to not only help us understand his religion, but also implement each and every rule and each and every fundamental of Islam properly. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our work in his cause. Ameen wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.